Hey, Jonathan. Happy
How's it
Tuesday.
Going?
Yes, I can hear you.
You too.
Oh, all right. You're doing these videos now and they're awesome. I just want to give you kudos for that. But let me just make sure I got everything situated here. We're broadcasting. Yay. We can see each other, hear each other. And I'm screen sharing where folks can see this whole intro. Macro to Micro Power Hour starts now. Greetings, I'm Samantha LaDuc, founder of LaDucTrading.com and CIO of LaDuc Capital LLC. I have with me, very luckily on Tuesdays, Jonathan Gibbons of VigTech.io. We have a very different approach to studying the market, but we oftentimes come to a similar place and love to take temperature of what he's reading, what I'm reading, compare, contrast, if you will, and time. Market turns. I think this week in particular, we have some potential kind of runaway activity in this gamma, single stock gamma option world that I definitely want to revisit with Jonathan since he's been tracking this very closely with some tools that he has developed in partnership with his colleagues. And they have really added a tremendous level of support, if you will, to when that whole option world is glomming on to a particular trade and where there might be some risk as it relates to air pockets below. So we're going to revisit that. He showcased some of his product features last time. I am talking to myself right now because I just realized I've got the stop share on, but this is what I wanted to show you. This is his home right here. Complex Investing Made Easy, vigtech.io. This is my home. We, by the way, will have that loaded onto YouTube after, but otherwise, LaDucTrading.com, you can come here for interviews and see the scheduled interviews. I've got Bob, my oil trader, coming on Thursday, and past interviews. This is where the interview will be stored right after we're done. You can also go to my YouTube channel and to VigTech's YouTube channel. You've started something live, which is brilliant. So you're doing your daily posts now and building up that support or educational channel on YouTube. So yeah, we got it going on. VigTech, LaDuc Trading, we're here. Let's unshare and have a little conversation about what you are seeing in the markets.
Gamma, gamma, gamma.
Gamma, gamma, gamma.
Oh my goodness. You know, we were talking about it last week and you know, I started doing those, you know, kind of the videos each evening, which is so much easier. I'm glad everybody likes them. That kind of look at the markets as a whole, and then just going to go under the hood, I guess you would say. And you know, we were joking last night. Yesterday, I was joking because the indexes went down, right? Well, not the indexes, but the broker dealers went down. And yesterday morning, and so there wasn't
a lot. Chaos.
It was total chaos. And then the stock, the options were like not getting bid as much. And so you saw we've been tracking a figure. It was 0.60 on our side. It's an arbitrary number that we just use, but it broke yesterday. It was 0.67. And I was like, well, you know, they're reviewing it in the play booth because like the review booth in the NFL, because they need to see if this is really going to stand or not overnight, or if we're going to come back today. And they're going to let them redo it. Sure enough, they redid it today. And I think we set the record today on our scale of the last 16 days. This is 0.27.
Wow. That's almost zero. Like,
yeah. Yeah, totally. Yeah. 0.26. It looks
like. Can we go negative?
I don't know. I don't know. You know, this is starting to get like, you know, I've been thinking, and I was just going to throw this out there. I don't know, you know, what all you want to look at specifically because we can go wherever we want to go today, but like the, to me, I was looking back at like going to 2018, because if you go back to 2018, the beginning, it seems like since then that things have bifurcated, and it really has been prevalent in the derivatives, but really evident in the options. And, you know, it's been these huge cycles I talk about every time, but it seems like that this is somewhat of like, it's taking it to the next level of that whole, where it's not, what are we really doing here market, right? Like, what's really transpiring? Because it's not, it's rotation, it's some of these other things, but this single stock gamma infrastructure is just getting way out of hand. And, you know, I just looked at a Russell Weekly right before we got on the call. I can share it if you want me to.
Go ahead. You're free to. Yeah.
Okay. Here, let me pull this up. Like, if you look at the Russell Weekly, like this is this year.
You now do it for XRT.
Oh, yeah. Retail. Same boat. Right?
Now do it for IPO. Come on, let's play. Now let's do it for that ARK ETF for genomics, ARKK, ARKG. Thank you very much. All right, we could do this all day. So
this is just
let's do it for Tesla.
I'm curious what your take on all this is, because like in 2018, it seems like something may have broken, because it started in 2017, the same type of parabolic structure, and you saw it break, and there was just this huge meltdown in like 3 to 7 days, trading days. And then you saw XIV implode. They changed the way they were dealing with liquidity. And then you get the huge run up in 18, and then it breaks again in 19. You get the phone call on Christmas Eve to Mnuchin while he's in Cabo. You know, he's on the boat, fix it, right? And then the Fed and Treasury start to merge, and then you just start to get this runaway action. And it just seems like, you look at this right here, this is just runaway action. And then what's transpiring here, right? Are we dealing with a bit of hyperinflation to an extent, and some things that you wouldn't
know? Just yeah. Perception of it, I think, inflation premium.
Yeah. So I was curious your take on this, because I was looking at this and I've looked back, and you have some price action up until 17, to the tail end of 17. And since the tail end of 17, it just gets really like exacerbated both ways. And now it's just the chase is on. And the infrastructure of the derivatives is a concern for me at this point.
Yeah, no question about it. Let me show you what I've got too. Just some key charts that I grabbed, some of which I have tweeted and such. This is all that option, the call buying activity. This goes all the way back to the early 1900s. So this, and then I think Spot Gamma had said, but this is actually the IV is still to play catch up. So they're mm-hmm. running the premium, they're just running. The tail is wagging the dog. It's just no question. And yet the question that I had was, how much of that is retail? How much of that is kind of like the CTAs? And it was more in the 21% are the small lot call buying by the Robin Hooders and the rest of the folks that have gotten into the market very strong since March. That's a significant number for market makers. Have you talked with any of your market maker friends to see how they're handling this? Because it seems very much that aside from the liquidity that the Fed and the global central banks have infused, $29 trillion, you also have the work from home contingency that is very, you know, bullish with the SPACs, with weed, with, you know, the EV plays, the Teslas of the world, and it's been working. So I, of course, with you, feel that this is very fragile, very much a la 2008. And then, of course, they pass stimulus. It's less than expected. But the point is this whole reflation combined with speculation and IPO bid is that which reminds me very much of 2008, you know, when they passed the stimulus and thought everything was going to be hunky-dory. And then we proceeded to have a 49% waterfall cascade into 2009. So this, to me, though, is they're searching for yield still, right? So they're moving into the, you know, the reflation trades because they need to do that search for yield. It's, I mean, I bought Oxy a few days ago because it had a 12.2% trailing dividend yield. And it looked like, you know, the energy market wasn't going to slow down, even though it had gone up to some resistance levels last week across all the oil and gas ETFs. I'm like, small cap energy still looks hot. Oxy has a 12% dividend yield. I'm going for it. I'm going to keep buying this because they keep coming in and buying this. It felt safer to me than chasing the SPACs, of which there are 196. We put together a list, and ridiculous. Snow, for example, this valuation on this ETF, SNOW, has a valuation 243 times revenue. So this is euphoric action that reminds me of the 1999-2000 and the 2008 into 2009. And the higher this goes, the more likely the parabola will break and come down just as hard and fast. So do I have a lot of open positions? Uh-huh. But I'm also looking for that, like you said, the gamma option flow slow down and then turn. And at some point, you're going to see it. I'm going to see it. Right now, I just see levels that are getting tagged in, you know, VIX, dollar, my stock bond volatility ratio. But yeah, your point of this 2008, this is not even my chart, but I like this because it shows, you know, this is 2018, this global crash that we had, right? We're in parabolic levels across the board. And yet, which one is it that I really wanted to show? Help. There it is. This 2009, this February, January, February of 2018, we had a very fast drop. We had it again January, February of 2020. Kind of interesting timing with pension rebalancing. Can't help but wonder, now that we've come back up to this trend line in NYSE, which, it, by the way, this is on a weekly, if we're going to have a similar kind of, what do you call the Gorpy action, where we're tagging next few weeks, and then we do a similar kind of rollover in January.
I think the same thing is kind of unfolding, and it's, you know, and I've been thinking about 2008 more than 2000, right? You know, and I don't have any experience back in 2000, just other than research, but 2008, it was the liquidity of the derivatives where it had gotten, so there, nothing goes down, right? And as nothing goes down, then they started to overlay, right? And they kept overlaying and they kept overlaying. And they created all the different CDOs and CLOs and everything off the CMBS. And it's because it never went down, right? And they get that logic and that kind of bidding infrastructure, so to speak, is what took it to a place where it outkicked the ability for it to create liquidity. Even if it were to say there wasn't a big time break or any type of trigger, there was just simply no more liquidity to suffice the situation. It inverts, right? And then it breaks down. And I think that this reminds me more of the options remind me more of the CDSs, not because they're the same thing. And I said this in the video last night, not because they're the same product or anything like that, but because they're derivatives of an underlying. So now there's greater quantities of the derivative in bulk. I've heard several people, you asked me what I've heard. I've heard that they're creating products and overlays for options. I've heard that the last week and a half, because it just doesn't stop, doesn't go down, and makers need to sell something to somebody. And so now we're getting into that, and you look at the SPACs, you know, the reverse IPO thing that, you know, that was going on with the Chinese for a little while.
Oh, the Chinese stuff. Yes. You know,
and they were doing that, but now we're doing it. And that's, again, kind of the same thing. We're just kind of culminating all these financially engineered products kind of at the same moment. And we're using the derivatives in the form of options, and the options are in everybody's hand in the phone. I'm curious to see what really transpires here at this moment in February, January, February timeframe, because I don't, you know, I'm not seeing anything that says it's slowing down yet. I can't.
Well, there, you just hit the nail on the head, I think, because I saw today that QS, for example, is one of those stocks that shorts found absolutely no inventory to cover. Can you see the QS?
Yep.
So one of these plays that shorts have literally no way to cover. There was not enough inventory. So is that similar to what you're talking about?
That's exactly what I'm talking about. Like literally there's no, the actual inventory for just a natural supply and demand purchase sale. Like, you know, you remember when the CDSs, they had like the same, everybody's read The Big Short, right? Everybody does the research back on that. They had the same house in seven tranches, right? And it's not anything except math when it's fine, when that house continues to rise and you're just continuing to sell and pass the trash and repackage it, so to speak. We're doing the same thing now, right? With a different product to an extent. And, you know, it's once that, what it's fine as long as it keeps going up. As soon as it turns, or when liquidity cannot suffice the situation any further, you get huge displacement. So like, yeah, it goes from 360 to 120, right?
This isn't the same thing, but I would point this out because they announced that they're going to be doing, they're going to raise money. You know, they're going to raise a whole bunch of money so that they can buy more Bitcoin. It's supposedly, you know, the largest holder of Bitcoin on a company balance sheet outside of the Bitcoin Trust, GBTC. And then in order to buy more, we're not talking software and the sale of, we're talking Bitcoin and holding of, they literally announced this morning, they're taking out a big old loan so they can buy more Bitcoin, 400 million. So they're turning into a hedge fund. I know, look at your eyes. So
who approved that? Like, who approved that loan? Get them on the phone. I want to talk to them. I got some stuff to sell them.
There's a celebrity CEO right here. And, you know, the Chamoffs of the world with their, you know, SPACs are just the next, I don't know what, holy grail. There's some funny stuff going on. And we're a market of funny stuff going on, right? We have all the buybacks. Have you heard, even you can't even Google now for buybacks. It's so low on the talk meter before, obviously, COVID. And that went out of fashion. What went into fashion? IPOs, these special purpose, conglomerates.
Asset conglomerates.
So we have a whole new breed of, like you just said, this rolling. New products.
Yeah, it's just, it's, you know, I think that between the SPACs and you have, I was looking for Bitcoin to roll and Bitcoin, GBTC is front running Bitcoin.
Yep.
And I had a 15 handle on that as a target, and that looks like it's in motion. This has front run since 2018.
Yep.
Every turn by about 30 to 45 days. You've got Tesla, which is...
Let's talk about Tesla, because today, this September, $720 calls were rolled from the 700. And back in October, that was beginning of November, because I tracked this, you know, like just mentally. And then back in October, they were $600 calls. This is a... I don't know, 200 million?
Yeah. Well, no, that's what I say. Like, I think people, you asked me.
That's,
you know,
a premium bet of size.
I think everybody's playing the game, right? Because you're going to, what are you going to do? Sit there and not play the game, right? It just depends on like your risk appetite or what have you. You can see that towards the final stages of something that the gains can be staggering as to the speculation. And this goes back 500, 700 years and all the cycles of speculation. When you read Devil Take the Hindmost or any of those great books, and we have a little quick blog about all of the ones in the last 200 years on the site, and how many there are and how often this happens. The tail end of those cycles always is huge gains and then huge busts. And so, you know, this is kind of, you know, I can't sit here and say, okay, this time is different. The vehicles are always different. You with CDSs, CMBS, you know, on the CMBS stuff, CLOs, et cetera. And now we have options that are in the hands of everybody that are, there's so many more contracts to the market than there are shares available, right? Mm-hmm. And that's going to have a problem, right? It's fine when the next guy's willing to buy a call or when things don't get, you know, issued, right? Or expired in someone's hands and they have to deal with all that. I wonder, you know, the underpinning dynamics of the actual, you know, because a lot of orders of that size, like let's just say that Tesla call you looked at right there, some of that stuff's still done over the phone, right? Once it gets to a certain size, it's not even.
It's like a bat, you know, phone if you get 200 million premium.
Right, like there's some phones, right? Like that are getting people, you know, and who's like, you know, and I think this is peak hubris and not in the hands of everybody, but in the concept or the perception that there's no fear and there's no consequence.
That's actually the we're at, I don't want to call it peak complacency, but because we haven't actually paused and then that case of vertigo hit and then roll over.
Yeah.
But it's very typical in these types of runs, even though they're doing this PE expansion business 6 years out. It's very typical for these to reverse violently and then take a while to settle before they move back higher. So this is what you and I are looking at. And I noticed, you know, your levels, which keep dropping, mm-hmm. like you just said, from, it was like 0.6 last week, I remember, 0.27. At what point do you say that's just not natural and something's going to break right here, right now?
Well, I think, you know, if you look at, let me pull this up. My two cents is like, it has to, there's so much froth. It doesn't just stop and turn unless typically, usually there's a little bit of a break, you know, a pause. And then there's like another weak attempt at the same gambit, and then it breaks down, or it kind of meanders and rolls for a week or two or 3 weeks, even can be a month, and then it goes. So, you know, I'm not seeing anything at this point, because we were at 0.67 yesterday. It was 0.3, 0.4, 0.5, 0.3, 0.2 for the last 15 trading days, or 14 up until yesterday. Then it went to 0.60. And what I'm referring to, for anybody that doesn't know, is we track options flows in our system. And then, you know, single stock option calls above a certain premium size and the top, let's say 150 traded options. So filtering out, you know, different factors that then give us a reading. 0.6 is kind of a threshold for us, that below 0.6 is just froth. Above 0.6 to 0.1, normal, like, you know, PC type stuff, but 0.60 less. It's been 15 of the last 16 days, discounting yesterday as being tossed out because the exchange fumbles with the actual data getting over to the providers and so forth. So this is like unprecedented. And so until it burns off, it can continue to burn you, right? And so it just is like, there's some point where it will level off before it then rolls over, right? And I don't see, yeah, I don't want to mess with this until it levels off. You would be trailing it up like you're doing, right? I think that's what everybody's doing. But it's, you know, it's at this point, I don't even think you need a trigger. I don't even think you need a catalyst. I don't think you need anything except liquidity to break, because it was liquidity that broke the CDSs. It was, and it's what it is everybody that's selling the shit right now is going to turn around and they're not going to be there to buy it back, right? So once it rolls, just like the mortgages, it was, everybody's seen the movie Margin Call, if you haven't.
Yep.
Who's the first guy out the door on these sizable trades like Tesla? That's when this thing cracks and everybody else is just a dead body, right? And so I think you don't, you know, you might see some, you should see some shaking on that, in my opinion, ahead of time. I'm not seeing it yet, and I don't think you are either. I could be
I'm already shaken though when I see this type of thing. So Actually, a client in my trading room asked me, what are PE ratios, forward looking PE ratios for the Russell? And I was like, yeah, that's a good question, because they were already wicked elevated, right? And I don't mean just from March, but I mean from the Biden bid back in October into November, then the election, blah, blah, blah. Then energy took off. We had the Pfizer vaccine on November 11th, and hot fire flames from there. But check this out. This is forward PE Russell, okay, Russell 2000, on a weekly basis. The PE had to be capped at 60 because it's never been that high.
Yeah, we're pulling all the growth of everything for the foreseeable future to right now in the middle of a shutdown.
And so that's why when you were talking about inflation, that's where I go, no. So this is where I'm saying what the heck is that? Forget it. Where this crude oil, if you will, typically tracks US reflation expectations. And it has done a really good job of that. This is Q4 18 that you were just talking about before mm-hmm. our big swoosh, right? Mm-hmm. Everything pretty much is being compared to that January 2018 swoon. But now look at this. This is from the bottom. Obviously, reflation expectations are way to heck up here. And here's crude. So they're not tracking anymore. That's a divergence. I look for that kind of stuff. So to me, I am more inclined to believe that this reflation expectation has gotten away, right, from mm-hmm. many that were not positioned for the value rotation from growth. And now they're purely the FOMO crowd, fear of missing out. And they're absolutely adding and chasing. And you can see it. You can see it institutionally, where they're adding plays that have a higher dividend. That's really a reason I went into Oxy with a 12%. And it was phenomenal. I mean, it moved 13% the next day. It is not supposed to move like Jagger.
No, 13% is a standard deviation move that is not the, that's like an option trade, right?
So to me, inflation expectations look, oh, there's the cat again, look an awful lot like the gamma stuff that's going on.
Oh yeah, completely. Well, because it's just moving from, at this point, you can almost like watch it just move around and just suck up the next move and suck up the next move. I think it's almost like whatever perceived to be a discount is getting caught up in this. This is a mania. I don't know that you can use a word. You can't use another word. This is speculative mania. And it's not like, oh no, it's speculative mania. It's terrible. It's a part of it, right? And now it's froth. And there's a perception that you cannot lose. Right. And it's totally detached from the underlying of everything. We're talking about, what'd you say about snow? 245 times revenue?
Revenues.
245 times revenue. That company is not even that old.
Right? No.
It's going to be a great thing for sure. But, we're grabbing everything from the future, which is what the interest rate suppression does. It pulls the entire future forward to right now. And we're pulling the entire future forward to right now. So you got to think, what does that look like for the 2020s? And I think
that's going to be a problem. So we're going to have a tough time.
Right, yeah.
We're going to have a tough time for 21, 22, into 23, most likely. I show this chart. I grabbed this from Twitter, and it is just one of my favorites all of a mm-hmm. sudden, because it shows this very asymmetrical reward, in my opinion, risk reward for an outlier that will revert. This is the RIDEX cash balances, which are, for lack of a better word, on the floor. As you can see, our index in, blue sky territory, that is another little, example of potential danger. But I like your analogy of this 2018 fundamentally, but I still like the 2008 reference of they thought the stimulus was going to help, and then we rolled over 49%.
Yeah, I think that you're totally probabilistic in that assessment. I don't think I had said yesterday on the video that I made last night, you can see that there's a level pretty much in every stock, right? If you look at most of these, and we'll just look at like SPY and jump out of the weekly, look at it just on a daily basis. If you look at this 336 level right here,
mm-hmm.
right, that 336 level, It's 274 in the Qs. It's 155 in IWM. It's the same spot on everything. It's the same spot on VXX and UUP. It's the same spot on the euro. It's the same spot on gold. It's the same spot everywhere that there's either a correction and this continues. This just finds a way to continue, or this gets really hairy. And if this continues to grind up the way it is speculatively right now, the likelihood that this comes down hot versus corrective increases the likelihood of your case, in my opinion, that you get a 50% type whack, just oh, we didn't see it coming type thing, because it will cut that like a blade for all of these charts. And if you look at every one of these ones, they're in the same. So I'm just looking at, if I step back and we take all this macro stuff out, take the cash balances out, take everything out, I just know that there's these pivot points sitting right there in the market that are what, you know, 10 to 12% lower than where we are now. And if we go up another 6-8%, let's say, right, 5%, just get really crazy, that turn on those is going to come down way hot and it's not going to be a correction. And that could very much disrupt it. That would to me describe an event versus a correction, right? So
We have a few potential risk events coming in. The Brexit, I know, 2016, we were horrified. Now it looks like, you know, a tame little puppy dog, but it is still a threat. December 11th, we have, you know, the budget deadline, quote unquote, government shutdown risk. Gosh, what if the vaccine doesn't work? Or, you know,
they're betting everything.
Everything.
That's a full opening, right? That's a full opening. I don't know enough about all that.
We're at levels pre-COVID. Like we just add, like you said, we added in this year, next year, the year after that, forward.
Yeah.
As if COVID never existed.
It's being bet, and I've heard this anecdotally from several people I would consider smart, that, well, we've got at least 3 vaccines coming in the spring.
Yeah.
This is over. Mm-hmm. I have heard that. And I was like, wow, you know.
But there's something that is also tangible that folks may not be considering in this, you know, PE expansion world. We have a lot of supply chain issues that are starting to percolate now with lots of sold out, not just Christmas season, but beyond electronics and the like. We did have a trade war, right? We had also the COVID disruption. So this is not being priced in. PE contraction doesn't exist in the minds of the bidders. It's only expansion. It's only this, you know, this reflation and reopening rally mode. It's only going to be blue skies ahead for SPACs and IPOs that have done really well because they keep getting this gamma flow. But I'm looking at this, as you do, for the triggers that could unwind the gamma beyond a big surprise. What if something happens, Electoral College, Trump, you know, the election inauguration, the deadline, Brexit, of course, the government shutdown, the vaccine disappointment. How about a dollar bounce that actually has teeth? We have overshot the monthly. It's mm-hmm. coming now back into a place of it could threaten to move higher. But we don't have right now anything that looks like semiconductors want to come back, even though they make this whole world, you know, our work from home world, go, and inflation expectations, which are far outpacing the reality of the commodities underneath. We are definitely on a bullish bent because the dollar has been so weak. At some point, those shorts, which are very crowded into dollar shorts, will start to realize some profits, maybe into year end. Maybe that whole pension balancing thing will spark a little bit of equity risk off, or at least selling of some type, profit taking, tax gain harvesting. They're going to go to cash. They're going to take this stuff and go to cash. It's going to raise that risk flag. And you never know. It just does a little Jenga jiggle. That's all it needs.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I think I look at this as a lot like 8 in the sense that what tipped that over? What was the catalyst in 8? It just fell. Right. And it was who was going to get out of the door first. with the liquidity being the number one concern. And this seems to me like it could be not dissimilar. I mean, you could name your catalysts at this point. China came out yesterday and we're like, yeah, we're going to go back to 2015 and or before 16, all of U.S. policy. That's it. That's the gold standard. Just take it all back. Right. And that's where we need to be in geopolitical relations. That was the statement, right? Like, so, I mean, you got China, you got Taiwan, you've got, you know, the vaccine, which is like, you know, I think that that's hope, right? Overall, it's a hope. So we need it.
There's no question.
There's no doubt. So I'm all for it, but you know, the bets that everybody's placing on that being 100% effective to open everything back up into complete nature is a stretch. So need a catalyst at this point?
But it's a perfect storm of vaccine hopefulness, the trade war normalization, tariff removal, the pent up demand, the, you know, supply chain normalization, which I think is going to be a little bit harder, but add to that, you already have the monetary infusion. Now you've got the fiscal hope. It's interesting. No one really seems to be talking about the impact of the tax hikes, but they're apparently not a concern. The Biden bid is still in full view, but I like this chart as well. Same source where you can see it kind of hit this 2018. You nailed it. Everything looks so similar to that, right? Can you see this spike? February, yep. 2018, right? This was world excluding the US. This is what it looks like for real. Here we are.
Yep, I go back to like when it got them was this, and when it got them was in the end of 18, and they were all asleep and they took off the liquidity, you know, and the Fed and the Treasury were like on a break. And they it started with Powell there on September, into September in the Q4 of 18. And then it was by Christmas, it was just wheels were coming off. And I think that my preference to see this shake out, right? It's been, I don't want to see it fall apart, but like of how it would shake out is that it's going to be liquidity and then you'll be able to hang whatever catalyst you probably want to hang on it because we're getting to a place where we can't substantiate any of the market structure that's being created. And so it's almost like a pick and choose which way it could roll over. But and having said that, I really think that if it naturally kind of jogs down here and corrects and settles, you know, on like some end of year stuff to like kind of play on the end of the year comment, like if let's say it corrected into the end of the year, I think it probably makes it even more bullish into the first quarter because you know, everybody's going to like, as soon as 1-1 rolls around, put it back to work, right? Because you can't have money on the sidelines. You know, there's a lot of things that could transpire with how the next 8 weeks are pretty dicey. At the very best, I think I would say they're very dicey.
It's still to me this very important, like let's have a pause and reflect. They haven't done that yet. At some point they will get a rug pull and then say, wait a minute, maybe we need to lighten up, and that will create this safety. Dominoes. Yeah, this domino. But for right now, we definitely don't seem like, you know, COVID is a concern despite mounting deaths and the like. We definitely don't have market valuations that matter with the forward, you know, pull of all of the earnings expectations. We definitely don't seem to have an economy. By the way, the economy, even though there are green shoots and the like, aside from the jobless claims that are still affecting predominantly the service business and as a result, women in the she session, that's still alive and kicking. Main Street is still hurting. It's that doesn't remove any of that Main Street versus Wall Street, you know, stigma and pain. The debt overhang, though, that everyone talks about, it's so exciting to get more money, more money, more money, more money. Well, debt is deflationary just by the nature of it. So that's why I say this reflation rally, this reopening rally, as exciting as it is, and we play it. I mean, I got more longs than short, and I'm nervous about it every single day. Like I'm bullish, but with every trade, I expect to be wrong. It's just like, because I have to play it. This is,
you got to. Yeah, you have to.
I have to because I run a live trading room, but I also can see some opportunities, but it feels incredibly surreal. And with that, I still see this kind of TARP bailout 2008 when everyone thought, okay, we're fine now. And then we rolled over. That was October 2008. And then we rolled over. And you were talking somewhat about that comparison with the housing bubble too. Yeah, that's talk a little bit more about that, because there was a lag time from 2007 August to that October 2008 before the real damage started. So we had a whole year.
Yeah, absolutely. Once these things like get into motion, right? Like you figure, how long does something have to run its course through the system before it's done? And there's like musical chairs. There's just no, the music stopped and there's no chairs left. So the first guy's out, second guy's out, third lady, fourth guy, fifth lady, you know? And I think that when I, and I've just been contemplating this, so this is totally just, you know, some thoughts. I haven't really sat down and drawn the direct parallels. But when you look at the way the mortgages were structured, everybody was holding the same type of trash. And so, you know, being rehypothecated, it created mathematical problems when the liquidity disappeared. And that's why you saw just huge, huge write-offs, 95%, like total 100%, just total, this bond's totally gone. And it was like, we can't ever do this again, right? Nobody ever do this again. Because they had rehypothecated so many things many times. That same concept is floating around everywhere right now. And the perception is that it's fine because there's so much liquidity. And that hubris in the, and it's like a half hubris, half like thought about the Fed, that there's no way that the Fed or the Treasury will allow us to go illiquid on this. So the gambit of, you know, selling more options contracts than the underlying securities are even available, you wouldn't do it if you didn't have a put or guaranteed insurance policy. So it's the perception that they can fix that, right? No matter what I do.
They tried back with the Bear Stearns time, right? These hedge funds that had invested in subprime, they imploded in April.
Yeah, and so it takes, and so maybe you see something.
April 2007, sorry.
Maybe you see something blow up, right? And then you see this kind of start to die.
We had repo in September 2018, remember?
I'm telling you, 19. All started in 18. Something broke in 18 in February, and it's been getting band-aided.
Yeah, absolutely.
I don't know exactly how. Right now, and then it's created these unintended consequences, and here we are kind of at this crescendo of that situation. And I think it's mathematical, and I think it's the system is fighting for its life. And I think I go back to our dollar conversation about China and all something. Maybe there's something that has to happen where the dollar has to appreciate or just naturally appreciates, and it causes these adverse effects. And that like Brent Johnson's been hammering about that a little bit lately, and people in the business, but like I I'm still in the long dollar crowd that trade is not, that's not even done, close to done, running north. But you know, what is it that triggers that, right? I think it's just math. I think when you have two, you're selling more options contracts than can be supported by the underlying environment. As long as everybody's reissuing, like closing and rolling, right? It's fine, right? Because I'm just closing and rolling, right? It's not really having any kind of negative impact. It's not, there's not any write downs or nothing. There's just gains. It's like a wealth effect to an extent, right? Same thing as the MBS, where as long as they keep increasing in value, the thing works. And that's how all those models were built back in 2008. Well, you know, the whole point of the movie, The Margin Call, when they were breaking down, he says, well, just if we take this much of a hit, this all breaks. And so it becomes a mathematical domino problem, right? And so once we start doing this derivative stuff, and it's interesting, you saw SoftBank step out, right? Why would they step out? Like they were killing this. Why would they step out?
So I they think, said, and- because, yeah, because they were clearly distorting the market. You know, just on your thought back in the 2008, I know we're having kind of a philosophical discussion about it. It seemed to me that they underreacted, like they didn't really get it together. They didn't really know what was going on and how to address it. In contrast to, you know, fast forward to March 23rd, 2020, they overreacted. I mean, the flood of liquidity and the increase in the balance sheet, unprecedented worldwide, but especially for the US. This to me is the same problem, but on the other side. So the tail risk, if you will, on one or the other, we have, that's why I'm very, very worried about this deflationary impulse that people aren't, I'm trading reflation trades. It's not the same thing as having a macro view like you and I discuss, right? So
yeah.
It's very clear that they underreacted then 2008. When did they start cutting? September.
I think it was underreaction, but I also think there was a level of understanding they didn't have.
Yes.
They didn't have any, they had no concept of how bad the situation was that they had created.
But they sparked the same outcome, which was this run for yield, this speculative stock market mania. I mean, things started taking off like hot fire flames, my expression for, you know, parabolas that are getting chased in the gamma hunt. So back then it was stocks. Now it's options. Back then it was global hunt for yield. Now it's global hunt for yield. Back then it was speculative mania on whatever, pick something, tech.
Anything, yeah, yeah.
And now we have the same thing. The symptoms are the same, but they underreacted then, they overreacted now, but we still have the same, sickness.
Do you think March was it?
Like, what do you mean March was it? I think September
2020, do you think that you said they overreacted in March? Do you think that that was it, or was that the... them throwing the, I mean, I don't know what I'm dealing with, so I'm just going to throw it all at it. And then I'm in a different place, even more complex than I just was in March. And I don't know what I'm dealing with now either. And I've got these other impacts that are sitting on top of it. And that to me is like, I think the kind of the real rub is like, since 18 in February, they threw stuff at it. It reacted a certain way. End of 18 into 19, where it was in Christmas, they threw something at it. And we're just kind of, it's on the wobbles to an extent, and they keep throwing things at it more. And
because they can't deal with the results if they don't. But I think the same problem they were trying to address, which was the credits, blew out, the credit spreads blew out, right? So they
Because you're always on top of the yield stuff, right?
Well, no, it's just that I'm trying to understand the similarities. I'm thinking 2008, they had to compress that whole, risk premium in the credit markets. They needed to obviously get control of volatility, because volatility reprices everything. I think that was also when we had extreme, speaking of speculative mania, oil went to 140, crude went to 140 a barrel, right? We were at rates though, much, much higher, 6%. But the point is those things came down, they cut, they the same thing that they have done since they stepped in to intervene in March, it's to compress all